We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
The dialogue. The community voice of Southern California's young professional network. Relevant discussions about the thoughts, concerns, opportunities, and challenges faced by today's generational leaders. Real talk, real people. This is The Dialogue. The Dialogue. With Starlett Quarles on LA Talk Live and streaming live at www.latalklive.com.
Wait, I had to get on beat. Okay. All right. Welcome back. Good evening. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome once again to The Dialogue. Real talk, real people. I'm your host, Starlett Quarles, and we're on live at latalklive.com and streaming all over your internet and now on your smartphone. So if you go to latalklive.com on your smartphone, they're going to prompt you, say okay. And there you go. There you have us. We're on the road with you in your pocket on your smartphone. And as always, The Dialogue is the voice of our generation. So thank you so much for joining us here every Wednesday from 5 to 6:30, where we like to discuss the topics that are relevant to today's generational leaders. I see y'all bobbing your head. Y'all know that? Y'all hear that? That is the legendary Stevie Wonder, and we are honoring him tonight, as did the Grammys did on Monday night. Did you guys see that show? It was an absolutely fabulous all-star tribute to Stevie Wonder. It's the best I've seen in live entertainment on TV, and I don't know how long, from every performer, from Beyonce to Annie Lennox was just... Annie Lennox, Jennifer Hudson, Pharrell, I mean, even the white performers. The white performers had to step up to the plate because you cannot jack up no Stevie Wonder song. So please, if you have not seen it, please try to find on YouTube. It is a tribute to the legendary Stevie Wonder. And we're going to be honoring him, and we are going to be rocking to some classic Stevie Wonder tonight as we continue our conversations with the next generation. If you recall, we started this focus on youth development last month in honor of National Mentoring Month, because we all know it takes a village to raise a child, but now it's going to take a movement to raise this generation. So thank you again for joining us tonight. We have an absolutely amazing show for you. You're going to meet some extraordinary young men tonight who are truly, truly beating the odds. Our guests tonight are Alex Johnson, who is the executive director of the Children's Defense Fund here in California, Chase Moore, who is a 12th grader from Bourbon Day High School, and his classmate Zachary Berg, who is also a 12th grader from Bourbon Day High School, all here tonight to help me continue our series on conversations with the next generation. And as always, this is a community conversation, so make sure you give us a call here, 323-473-3100, and you can always post your comments on our Facebook page, facebook.com/TheDialogueLA, or tweet me at StarkWarriorQuestions, or if you got my number, you know you can text me your questions. And of course, stay connected to us on our website at thedialoguela.com. We're doing a little update, but I do want to stay connected to you, so please, please join our mailing list at thedialoguela.com. We post our replays, we stay connected, we hear from you, we take your show suggestions, so check us out at thedialoguela.com. Now, before I go to a commercial break, I just want to take a quick moment to make an announcement for all you first and second year college students. JPMorgan Chase is now taking applications for its BA Early Advantage Program. Over the course of two days, students have the opportunity to meet with JPMorgan senior leaders, colleagues, and interact with some of the most talented students from diverse backgrounds across the entire country. While building their network, you participate in personal branding workshops and leadership training sessions all designed to position you for career success. This takes place Thursday, April 23rd, 2015, to Friday, April 24th. It is held at the J.P. Morgan Chase New York City offices, and this is open to exceptional students with cultural and diverse backgrounds and life experiences, including individuals from groups that have been historically underrepresented, who are currently in their freshman or sophomore years of college or university level, and you got to have a 3.2 GPA. The deadline for the application is Wednesday, March 4th of 2015, and you can apply at jpmorganchase.com/ba-early-advantage. Okay, we are going to now take a commercial break, and when we come back, we're going to continue our series on conversations with the next generation, and tonight's conversation with some young black men who are absolutely beating the odds. Right here with me, Starlett Quarles, on The Dialogue, Real Talk, Real People. We'll be right back. Hey!
February 28th from 10 a.m. to 9 p.m. Indigenous Rhythms presents the Culture Fest 2015 at the famous Simply Wholesome Restaurant located at 4508 Slauson Avenue on the corner of Slauson and Overhill. Enjoy live performances by X-Clan, Mad Lion, Medusa, General Jai Mikey, and much more, like vendors and delicious food served all day by Simply Wholesome Restaurant. The Culture Fest 2015, sponsored by Martin Cadillac, California Ticketmasters, and Undeniable Inc. For more information, go to indigenousrhythms.com.
Hi, this is Alan Ajoulay with Ajoulay Media Productions. I'm really excited to bring you Groove to the 70s, an indoor live concert event playing Saturday, March 7th, 2015, featuring Smooth Sounds of Santana and Creedence Relive, two of the best tribute bands in America. Tickets are only $29, part of which will benefit Honorable Recharge, a wonderful foundation, nonprofit, assisting combat veterans. Get your tickets now at latalklive.com or Facebook 70s Groovin'. And stick around for the after party with our LA Talk Live DJs Veneric Marshall and Mario Alvarado, spinning great tunes that will take you back. And check out the option to purchase a VIP ticket for a vet. So come to the Old World Village, conveniently located just off the 405 freeway and Beach Boulevard in Huntington Beach, for this memorable evening. Bring your friends or that special someone. I hope to see you there.
Welcome back to The Dialogue, Real Talk, Real People. I am your host, Starlett Quarles, and we are honoring our Stevie Wonder tonight. This is, of course, Love's in Need of Love. Tonight we are continuing our series on conversations with the next generation, and tonight we're having conversations with young black men who have absolutely beat the odds despite their adversities, despite their socioeconomic situations. And you know, I love showcasing our diamonds in the rough out here in South Los Angeles. So as always, this is a community conversation. We want to hear from you. 323-473-3100, 323-473-3100. 3100. You're going to absolutely fall in love with these two young men tonight. We're going to also ask you at the end of the show to support them. And I didn't get the chance to get the website for the scholarship, but we will get that at the end of the show. But you're going to love our show tonight on conversations with young black men who are beating the odds. Let me jump right into introducing our guests, starting with Alex Johnson, who is the executive director of the Children's Defense Fund here in California. We first met Alex when he was on my show last year as a candidate for the Los Angeles Unified School District Board. But now he is back to share with us what he is doing with urban youth out here in Los Angeles and his work with the Children's Defense Fund. So we invited him back to catch up with him and see what he's doing. And as well, he's brought some of his students with him, some of his honorees from his 2014 Beat the Odds Scholarship Award. So please welcome Mr. Alex Johnson to the dialogue. Welcome back.
Thank you, Starlett.
How you doing?
I'm good.
Good. So everything's good at the Children's Defense Fund. I'm so excited that you have this opportunity. I'm looking forward to hearing what you have to say.
Well, everything's good at the Children's Defense. Everything's great at the Children's Defense Fund. But we still have a long way to go for our young people.
Absolutely.
I'm glad to be here with Zachary and Chase, who represent what we're all about. And we're all about making sure that our young people, our boys and young girls of color, are lifted out of poverty, lifted out of horrific circumstances, that they have a foot forward in the game, that
Absolutely.
We are leveling the playing
Fantastic.
Field for them.
So let me introduce our two young black men today who are beating the odds. We have Mr. Chase Moore, who is a 12th grader at Bourbon Day High School, and he was also a 2014 Beat the Odds honoree. Welcome, sir. How you doing?
I'm doing good.
I see you got a little Ash Wednesday going on.
I do.
When you walked in, I was going, oh, you got something on your face. But then I realized.
Yeah, Ash Wednesday.
So good. So welcome. I know we had connected at the awards ceremony last year, and I said, I'm going to have you come on my show. So thank you so much for following up
it's
with me.
It's an honor to be here.
All right. Fantastic. And we have Mr. Zachary Bird. How you doing, Ziba?
I'm doing good.
12th grader, Bourbon Day High School. He is also another 2014 Beat the Odds honoree. Sponsored by the Children's Defense Fund here in California. How you doing, sir?
I'm doing fine.
Everything good?
Yeah.
All right. Fantastic. So for those of you who aren't familiar with the Children's Defense Fund, let me just introduce you a little bit to the organization. Of course, we're going to get into some dialogue with Alex more in depth, but let me read to you real quickly the purpose of the Children's Defense Fund. It says here, the Children's Defense Fund, California, believes that California's long-term prosperity depends upon all children having the opportunity to thrive and succeed. Every day, we champion programs and policies that ensure a level playing field for the most vulnerable children and youth. We aim to dismantle the cradle-to-prison pipeline that affects too many of our youth by expanding opportunities for children to grow up in safe neighborhoods, access comprehensive health care, and be educated in positive learning environments. That sounds like a whole lot y'all are doing over there at the Children's Defense Fund.
We're moving. We're making sure that young people have a head start, have a healthy start, have a fair start, have a safe start, and have a moral start in life. That's what we're about over at the Children's Defense Fund.
You have a fantastic array of programs that I just want to share with our audience. You have some programs and some priorities that you have focused on. So your programs are, of course, Beat the Odds, why our gentlemen are here, and we're going to discuss a little bit more about that. Your Freedom School, which you know, we have been talking about these Freedom Schools.
Yes.
So your Freedom School program, you have a youth leadership and development. You have a school-based health outreach and enrollment. And then your priorities, the things that you guys focus on at the organization, ensuring access to quality health care coverage and care, reforming juvenile justice, which is very interesting because you're paralleling that with this Freedom School. So I know you're going to share, I'm jumping ahead, but I'm so excited about, you know, what you're doing with, you know, our youth that are incarcerated, and promoting effective school climate practices and ending child poverty. Now, I was introduced to this organization and these young men last year at the Beat the Odds award ceremony. And Richard, I'm just going to ask you to play that gif of all these pictures. So these are my little pictures, so they're a little ghetto looking, but I just wanted to show how extraordinary this Beat the Odds awards ceremony was last year, and they honored five. In addition to our guest tonight, they had honored five youth, and I have their names here. Okay, so in addition to Zachary and Chase, it was Elizabeth Lopez, Sequoia Canada, and Timothy Walker, and they played these videos, and we're gonna give you some excerpts of these videos tonight. But the award ceremony was absolutely fantastic. I didn't believe all the celebrities that were there. I mean, Alex, how did you pull this event off? I mean, when I was going, I thought it was going to be a regular old chicken dinner. I really did. It was, you know, thought it was going to be a little chicken dinner. But it was extraordinary. It was fantastic. You had the MC. His name is, forgive me right now.
Conan O'Brien.
Conan O'Brien, duh. And then you guys see all these different celebrities that were pulling these awards together. How did you pull that off?
Well, look, this event has been going on for this year 25 years. We are actually humbled to have a wonderful board of directors that supports our work, that believes in our work. We have a wonderful visionary leader in Mary Wright Edelman, who I'm humbled to work with in this new step. And this is about the kids. Mm-hmm. And frankly, people understand that if we invest in kids, we're investing in the next generation, we're making lives better for children. And people know that if we invest in the front end, we don't have to invest in the back end.
But what surprised me, you know, in addition to, because, you know, there's a picture there with me with Supervisor Mark Lee Thomas. I knew that there was some political affiliations with the organization, but you have really embraced the entertainment community and the white entertainment community, which I was very surprised. Do you know what I mean? To really get involved in helping. So how was it that you've been able to have this diverse group of supporters and really mobilize, I mean, some A-level you know, celebrities in Hollywood? You know, their films were done by, you know, producers in the industry. So why don't you share with us some of the celebrities that were you know, introducing our guests, as well as the ones who did the videos.
Well, look, we have Katie McGrath and J.J. Abrams. J.J. is director of Mission Impossible films and a host of other films. We have Carol Biondi, and we have Ruth Huvain and Kevin Huvain. We have a connection to the entertainment industry that we're simply thankful for. And through the generosity of our board of directors, those women serving our board and others, Reese Witherspoon, Journey Smollett, LaFonza Butler.
They give their all,
and they invest in these young people, and they bring the resources, mm-hmm. and they bring the individuals who do these amazing films of the stories of these young people. It's a labor of love.
Absolutely.
And we are just simply fortunate to have the opportunity to go into the lives of these young men and these young women and to tell their stories. And they tell their stories, and they're the best, narrators of the stories that they have, stories of overcoming
tremendous odds. I mean, and I'm going to encourage you guys to look on YouTube and find all five videos of our honorees from the 2014 Beat the Odds. You just have to see their stories and just amazed at how far they've come and where they're going. So I want you to tell us a little bit about the legacy of the Children's Defense Fund for people who aren't familiar with it, and the history of how it started, and Marion Wright Edelman, and so share with us how this all came to be.
So the Children's Defense Fund is an organization, a nonprofit child advocacy organization that has been in existence for over 40 years. Mm-hmm. And Marion Wright Edelman, for those who are not aware, is truly a visionary. She was a woman who was breaking down barriers and beating the odds herself during the time of the Civil Rights Movement.
She's still doing it. She was spunky. She was engaged. She was on point.
You can't beat her energy. Her passion. She lives, breathes, and dies each and every day to make sure that children are put first. And so in 1973, she started this amazing organization called the Children's Defense Fund, mm-hmm. an outgrowth of the 1969 Washington Research Project, which she had started, which was a law firm. And over the course of time, the Children's Defense Fund has grown. We have offices in 8 states, headquartered in D.C. Mm-hmm. The California office is the largest of the state offices.
Okay.
We are in L.A., we're in Oakland, we're in Sacramento. And we work, as you said, around programs, Beat the Odds, Freedom Schools, but also policies, mm-hmm. To make sure that the playing field is level for children and mm-hmm. that we're advancing priorities for children and youth, juvenile justice being one portion, making sure that we are eliminating poverty, making certain that we are reducing the negative impacts of parents and families who mm-hmm. don't have a living wage.
Mm.
And so this is an organization that is moving the ball, the needle forward for children. And you don't often have that. We often forget about children in our public policy.
Right.
That's what we're doing in coalition with others.
Now, one of the things that I absolutely love about the Children's Defense Fund is the establishment of these freedom schools. And Alex, you and I, you know, talk all the time about our lack of cultural competency.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know what I mean? Not only just within our community, but just within our school when it comes to African-American, you know, connectivity. And so, as I'm, you know, researching, but I knew about the Freedom School some time ago. I mean, the curriculum that was created in the 1960s to be able to get, you know, these black youth not only educated but civically engaged, you know what I mean, and active in what was happening during the Civil Rights Movement. So talk a little bit about these Freedom Schools and your curriculum and its impact at the onset in the early, in the 60s.
Well, look, it grew out of the 60s.
Right.
And Freedom Summer, and a period when black children primarily simply did not have access to the same quality education that their white counterparts mm-hmm. had. And so we see Freedom Schools in this current age as a gap filler, as a way to address the issue of summer learning loss, which disproportionately impacts children of color, mm-hmm. Children who do not have the level of socioeconomic opportunity that their peers might have. And so Freedom Schools was originally conceived as an opportunity to address literacy, which we know the literacy is a predicate, literacy rates are a predicate to whether or not you are going into the juvenile system, the adult right. criminal system, penal right. system as a whole, or whether you're going to college or going to have a career. If you aren't literate, you oftentimes are not going to be able to work. You're not mm-hmm. going to be able to write that check that you need to write. You're mm-hmm. not going to be able to do a lot. And so we're focusing on literacy, but it also focuses on self-esteem, self-awareness.
And civic engagement.
And civic engagement. Right, making right. sure that young people understand that they have an obligation to make certain that they're actively involved in the democratic process in their communities.
And how are you filling that cultural competency gap? You know, for our kids who aren't, you know what I mean, astute about our African, you know, history prior to the Middle Passage, or even understand. I mean, I was, you know, recently talking to a friend of mine who was talking to some students at Dorsey High School. I mean, these are high school students who didn't even know that black people were once enslaved. So there's a disconnect. There's a generational disconnect. Mm-hmm. So how is the Freedom School, in terms of its curriculum, kind of filling that gap on cultural competency?
Well, we have a team of teachers and academics and professors who make sure that we have a culturally competent curriculum each and every summer that we're operating it. Mm-hmm. They vet the books, they vet the curriculum, they make sure that the training for those who are imparting the curriculum, the teachers, the college students, others, that it is on point, that it is addressing those areas which are not often taught right. in our school system, because we have a school system that is often focused on testing, and we oftentimes leave out the issues of black culture and mm-hmm. others. And so we're trying to fill in the gap. We're stepping in the gap in many ways. And so the books that students read are tailored to their experiences and the Very experiences nice. Of their ancestors. Mm-hmm. And
this is both black and brown children.
Black and brown okay. children. Mm-hmm. All children.
Right.
All children. Because all children will benefit from the books that are read in Freedom Schools.
Okay. You took this to the Juvenile Justice Department. Here in Los Angeles, and you had worked, you know, with some men, some young men who were they in probation? Were they
probation?
They're on probation, so they're in this camp, mm-hmm. and you for a summer, you incorporate the Freedom School curriculum. How was that? How was that for them? And what was the impact? Did you see, you know, from these young men who probably didn't even know some of this, some of their history, some of this knowledge? Talk about the impact.
Well, you mentioned first of all, Supervisor Ridley Thomas. This was something.
Shout out MRT.
This was a collaboration with his office, with LA County Office of Probation, and the LA County Office of Education, mm-hmm. And the Children's Defense Fund. In the lead, we saw that there was a need to change the culture of our probation camps in LA County, the largest juvenile probation, or juvenile probation camps, largest juvenile probation system in the nation.
Wow.
With black and brown young men and women who at a point were often sent and we just left them there, didn't really care. We've mm-hmm. changed that dynamic. LA County, in both the probation department and the Office of Education, have moved the ball forward significantly in making sure that we are taking young people and moving them along a trajectory, that we're not just leaving them, not just letting them squander their lives in camps. We have a captive audience there. Mm-hmm. And so education has to be the point of that.
So after they went to this program, what were some of the feedback that you got from them? How did it impact them? I mean, how did it change them? How did it inspire them?
Well, we sought to inspire, change the culture in the camp. So we sought to show that probation officers and the education officials could work together, that they all had a common stake in making sure that young people were educated, that they all had a common stake in making sure that young people were rehabilitated.
Okay.
But specifically, we saw increases in literacy rates over the course of this program.
Very nice.
On an average, about 60 points from a pre and post test. We saw significant decreases in behavioral, in terms of class suspensions, in terms of class restructures, in terms of fights between students and guards, in terms of racialized violence in the camp.
We saw
harmony. And the first summer, we did two camps, 164 young men. We've expanded it significantly. to five camps. It's even taken root in Alameda County in their probation camp.
Nice, fantastic. Tonight, we're here to talk about your Beat the Odds scholarship program, which recognizes outstanding high school students in Los Angeles who have overcome adversity to excel in school and as leaders in their communities. The honorees receive a range of college and career readiness services starting their sophomore year to help them succeed in college and beyond, including SAT preparation courses, financial aid, college exposure, life skills development, leadership training, and ongoing mentorship. And we talked about mentorship and the importance of mentorship, you know, last month when we were recognizing National Mentoring Month.
Mm-hmm.
Talk about Beat the Odds. It's fantastic. How it got started, and how do you go about selecting your honorees?
So the Beat the Odds program was started 20 years ago,
okay.
25 years ago, actually. And we have, over the course of time, selected hundreds across the country of young people who are just overcoming tremendous adversity.
Mm-hmm.
And the program is intense.
How long does it last?
The program, young people, they're not children. Young people are starting in their sophomore year.
Okay, so you follow them for three years?
We follow them. We make sure that they are getting into college.
Very nice.
We're encouraging them to, and we partner with the Fulfillment Fund on this, and so the Fulfillment Fund is a strong partner. But making sure that they're going to college, making sure that they have all of those pieces that sometimes they may not even talk mm-hmm. about. So many of these young people are first-generation college students or soon-to-be college students. So we got to walk them through the financial aid process, mm-hmm. walk them through the essay process. They may not have been on a college campus, and so we're doing college tours. We have hundreds and hundreds of applications that come in California.
That's what I was going to say. You have hundreds and hundreds, and you've been doing it for 20 years, so I'm sure it has a reputation. So what do you look for? And you only choose five, right? Every year, do you only choose five?
We choose 10, and then we narrow it down to five finalists who are presented at the gala every December.
Okay, so what do you look for? I mean, you get all these applications. What stands out to you?
So what stands out is stories that Zachary and Chase are going to tell you okay. today. We're looking for young people who have exhibited tremendous academic success, who are participating heavily in their communities, their schools, their churches, their community centers, young people who we see that if we make some tangible investment in them, we know that they will succeed.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what you see in Zachary and Chase. Two young men, football stars, but not just football stars. These young men are excelling academically at Verbum Day. They're excelling in their communities. They're young men of faith. They're young men who exhibit leadership. They're young men who can articulate themselves
mm-hmm.
In a way that exceeds their age. And so we're looking for that unique young person who, if we put a small investment, we give them $10,000 as a finalist, we give them a range mm-hmm. of other tools, but if we put that small investment in them, we know, based upon the selection committee that selects them,
mm-hmm.
and through intense interviews, they will tell you about the intensity of the interviews that they go through,
okay.
And the questions around a table with 10, 15 adults lobbing questions at them, but in a loving manner. After that, and after reviewing their applications, we know
mm-hmm.
if we put some money in investment in this mm-hmm. young person, if we provide resources,
mm-hmm.
we know that this young person is going to succeed.
And that's the key, investing.
We got to invest.
And providing resources. You know what I mean? Because
yeah.
we're going to, you know, and that's true just for even our generation. You know, because we can get the education, but it's not until we have resources, and it's not until we have a network that we can leverage that really we can be able to succeed. Yes.
We'll start with thinking about it like this, and I agree to your point. If we put $10,000 for a college scholarship in a young person, think about what we, and put it in the front end, think about what we're spending on the back end if we
right.
didn't put that.
Right.
We're investing hundreds of thousands of dollars each and every year
mm-hmm.
for young people in our juvenile justice system, our adults in our penal system,
mm-hmm.
per individual.
Mm-hmm.
And we're putting $10,000 because we believe that that can make a tangible difference in their lives.
Mm-hmm.
So you see the return on investment.
Mm-hmm.
You see when you look at these two young men, when you encounter these two young men, when you hear their plans for their lives, how they want to change their communities, what that $10,000 means, and what the staff support and the love that's just given to these young people.
And if you were to believe what the media says, these men don't even exist.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
They want to focus on mass incarceration of black men and all kind of other things, but they don't want to even focus on, extraordinary young black men that are being trained and groomed and have mentors that are investing in them. So share with us, before we go to commercial break, some of your success stories of your Beat the Odds honorees over the years. Who stands out to you as you've seen this $10,000 investment that you guys have made just flourish?
One example that stands out of many is actually Chase's brother, who is a Fulbright scholar, was the starting quarterback on the Marist College football team.
Oh, we got some now, legacy, huh, Chase? We got some legacy going, all right.
He's now transferred to another top college, but he is going to succeed. He has his head on bright, and there are countless stories of others. Sequoia Kennedy, who you met, Elizabeth Lopez.
I did. They were fantastic. I wish we could get our girls on here. We got to get our girls.
Let's get them on here.
So, Richard, when you give me my little music to lead me out to commercial break, Stevie Wonder, we are talking to extraordinary young black men tonight, talking conversations with young black men who are beating the odds for our series, Conversations with the Next Generation. So give us a call here, 323-473-3100. 323-473-3100. We're going to introduce you to two men who have beat the odds, who are prime examples of what Alex had just mentioned in terms of investing in young black men who, despite their circumstances, despite adversity, despite what society tells them, still has their eyes on the prize and are achieving their goals. So give us a call here, 323-473-3100. We're going to take a quick commercial break, and we'll be right back.
We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
February 28th from 10 a.m. to 9 p.m. Indigenous Rhythms presents the Culture Fest 2015 at the famous Simply Wholesome Restaurant located at 4508 Slauson Avenue on the corner of Slauson and Overhill. Enjoy live performances by X-Clan, Mad Lion, Medusa, General Jai Mikey, and much more, like vendors and delicious food served all day by Simply Wholesome Restaurant. The Culture Fest 2015, sponsored by Martin Cadillac, California Ticketmasters, and Undeniable Inc. For more information, go to indigenousrhythms.com.
Interested in advertising your business, product, or service here on The Dialogue? Call 323-547-7748. The Dialogue will help you promote your business, increase your traffic, and bring in new clients through innovative and creative marketing packages, including affordable radio ad campaigns for small businesses. Find out more. Call 323-547-7748. That's 323-547-7748. Or go to www.thedialoguela.com. And now, back to The Dialogue. The Dialogue. With Starlett Quarles. Real talk. Real people.
This is the one. This is the one. You like that, Chase?
I like it.
Let me see you get it. Come on. Let me see you get it.
I'll be doing the salsa right now.
Yeah. Welcome back to The Dialogue. Real talk. Real people. We are honoring the legendary Stevie Wonder tonight. Don't worry about a thing. Just don't worry about a thing. We are having community conversation with young black men who are beating the odds. We want to hear from you. 323-473-3100. I just love me some Stevie Wonder. This is my song right here. We want to hear from you. Please give us a call here to talk to our young men who are beating the odds, Mr. Chase Moore and Mr. Zachary Burkham. I'm so excited to introduce you two. How you guys doing?
I'm feeling
you like
blessed.
That you like that Stevie, right?
I do. I like Stevie.
What you know about Stevie, Zach? What you know about Stevie?
Yeah, I know.
You came in here talking about our music. I said, oh, you know, I'm about to give you some Stevie tonight.
Nah, I just grew up, my mom listened to it, my grandma listened to it, so I kind of grew up on Stevie Wonder.
Did you guys see the special at all? Y'all probably studying for school, huh?
Yeah, studying for school mainly.
Get no sleep, really.
Yeah, I know. Y'all pledging. Y'all online. Online for college.
It feels like that.
It does. Okay, so fantastic. We have let me reintroduce you. So we have Chase Moore, who is a 12th grader at Bourbon Day High School, and his classmate and football teammate,
yep,
Zachary
friend.
Berg. They call you Zebo.
Yeah.
Why they call you Zebo?
It's weird. It's funny. I got the nickname from a senior when I was in ninth grade because I don't even know why. Why did I get the nickname, Chase? They started calling me that, and that was my name.
You know Debo?
Yeah.
From Friday?
Yeah, but his name starts with a Z, so it just stuck.
Well, welcome, stuck. Guys. How you guys are going through college? When I talked to you the first time, you said, so how you doing? You said, stress. We going through all these college applications. So what is that process like? Tell me what's going on with you and your college application process.
It's pretty hectic.
Where are you applying to?
I applied to over like 30 schools.
Wow.
Yeah, to name a few: Holy Cross, the University of Pennsylvania, Lafayette College, Fordham, Villanova, TCU.
You have a preference?
Yeah, right now, the University of San Diego and Holy Cross.
Why there?
Football purposes.
Okay.
And Holy Cross, we have a lot of alumni from Bourbon Day that have went there, and I've heard nothing but great experiences about it. And it also caters to my major.
Okay, so you filled out 30 applications. You had to do 30 personal essays. Yeah?
Yeah.
Wow. Where are you applying to?
I'm applying to a lot of Ivy League schools.
Oh, okay. I know you said Harvard, yeah, where my daddy went. You want to go to Harvard? It's cold.
I know.
It's cold. They got a snow. You ready for that East Coast weather?
I'm ready.
You ready? Yeah. All right. So tell us where else you're applying to, sweetie.
Yale, Dartmouth, Princeton, Duke, Holy Cross as well. Brown, California, Berkeley,
Columbia,
USC.
Ladies and gentlemen, do you hear this? Do you hear these colleges that these young men are applying to? Thank you, Richard. So how was the college process going for you? How's the application? You stressed?
Applying to Ivy League is really stressful.
You're not cutting and pasting?
You can't cut and paste. Because each one is asking you different things. Like on the Columbia application, they'll ask you, why do you like reading Harry Potter or something like that?
You like reading Harry Potter?
Nah, but okay. That is one of the questions, though.
So it was creative writing for you.
Creative
because
writing.
You don't like reading Harry. Okay, very good.
Yeah, or on the Cornell application, they asked me why that I want to apply to the School of Neuroscience and Biology. And I had to explain why biology was the major I wanted to major in and things like that.
Okay.
And then when you apply to Harvard, they tell you, like, express how you spent most of your summers.
Mm-hmm. And you know, Harvard is giving money away to young people of color.
Yeah, I know. That's what I'm trying
Shout
to
out
there.
To LeBron. You said you talked to LeBron James.
I talked to LeBron.
And it's not basketball LeBron. It's my friend from college, but he went to Harvard, and he's helping students, black students, get into Harvard. So you gave LeBron a call?
I gave LeBron a call. I talked to him. He told him I needed to get my letter of recommendation to the Harvard admissions staff. He's able to help me there.
That's what you do. You invest. You provide resources. So what is your major, sweetie? What are you looking to do?
Looking to be an architectural engineer.
Architectural engineering.
Yes,
where did you get that one from?
Man. It's either that or possibly industrial and designs or possibly civil engineering. All I know for sure is I want to be an engineer because I want to build things.
So were you the kid that took the phone apart just to see how it worked and the computer apart? Was that you?
No. That would be a bike for me. I kind of get a little bit more dirty than that.
And so what inspired you to know that that was something that you wanted to get into?
I have funny stories to everything.
Okay, I'm sure.
Yeah.
You guys both have fantastic personalities. But tell me a little bit about what inspired you to want to get into architectural engineering.
Okay, well, I started off around 3 years old, you know, playing with Legos and everything.
Okay.
And I started to realize I'm pretty creative. And I just had fun, you know, showing my creativity and building things at the same time.
Nice.
So then that translated to me taking apart bikes or, you know, just taking things apart at home and putting them back together.
All right.
And that helps lead to a career path for me because there's a certain problem that I have in society currently, and I'll actually like actively be able to do a difference about it. I have a problem about the public funding in the public sector.
Okay.
Like in, you know, public schools and etc.
Okay.
Because I feel like they have lack of opportunities, lack of resources, and by being an engineer, by building and designing things, I'll be able to like make a tangible difference in
very
that
nice
way.
All right, you want to change our urban landscape. So we talked about real estate development.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, we did. Okay. Mr. Zach, what do you want to be when you grow up?
I want to be a oral surgeon.
Oral surgeon.
Orthopedic surgeon. I haven't really decided whether I'm going to medical school.
How did you go from the mouth to the feet? Which do you prefer? Those are just like just two different, you know what I'm saying?
It's not
you want to be in somebody's mouth?
Or I want to like, it's not just the feet, it's like your spinal cord, knee.
Oh, okay. Like you gave me. Yeah, I'm just, you know.
If the feet get injured, I could probably fix that too.
Okay.
Like, it just translates to, like, throughout my life, I was really injury prone. My mom and my family members joke and say that I have 9 lives because I was always,
you
like,
danger prone?
Yeah, I was always just doing, I was reckless.
Is
really,
he danger prone, Jet? You seen him?
Yeah.
I'd jump off, I'd, like, take risks, and I just, like, I don't care, really. I throw my body. Like, I play one of the hardest positions to play. I play every position, really, on our team.
Okay.
You know?
He's
like,
played with a broken rib before.
Yeah. You played a broken rib before?
I played the broken rib for the last 6 games of the season, actually.
How did you know it was broken?
Because it was purple and it wouldn't like stop turning. It kept getting like darker purple.
And so what inspired you to want to keep playing? I would have been like,
my team needed me.
Your team needed you. That's right. All right. So you guys both attend Bourbon Day High School, which is, it's in
Watts.
Yeah, Watts to be specific.
It is in Watts. So tell me what you love about your high school. What you love about Verb?
Man.
Give Verb a shout out.
It would have to be more on a more personal factor.
You take it personal. I just want to know.
Yeah, I come from a single parent home and everything. You know, I'm literally the man of the house since the age of 14. So, you know, coming to school to all dudes every day, like having a father figure as a teacher.
So when you first found out you were going to go to school with all guys, what'd you say? Were you just like, what's going down? It's prison? I mean, what's going on? What'd you say?
No, honestly, I had no words. I had no choice. Like, my brother, he was like the face of the school and everything. So
It was
only
legacy.
Right that I had to. Okay. I had to go to Verb.
Okay, so where were you going before that? What school were you going to?
I'm sorry. I was going to Curtis Middle School in Carson.
Okay, and so what was your philosophy before you got to Verb? Because I know Verb had a very, you know, strong impact on you. So before you went to Verb, and I know you had a brother who went there, but what was your own personal philosophy towards education and your own personal goals? Where were you before you got to Verb?
I wasn't the honor roll student I am today.
Okay.
Before Verb Day in middle school, I kind of wanted to be like the class clown, the funny guy. Cool. You know, I want to make people laugh and everything.
Okay.
So academics, that wasn't an important factor in my life at that time.
So why do you think you want to be the class clown?
To have acceptance, because during that time it was really hard for me, you know, not having a father. Because there's an experience I had when I actually saw him, like for the first time in like years, and it hurt me. So in result, I just started to act out.
Okay.
And I wasn't on my game that I am today.
So did you ever consider, you know, doing anything in the underground economy? Were you attracted to the gang life? Or you even attempted to get in? And if not, what prevented you from going that direction?
I was attracted with that life. I didn't do it personally because I'm kind of a small guy. Okay. Or at least I was at that time. But I still hung around the guys that would smoke weed, ditch class. I mean, I participated in that.
Okay.
You know, fight and everything. But I personally wasn't really interested in the gang life. But I was definitely incorporated with it. Or the, you know, the drugs and everything.
All right. And then you got to Verb and your whole world changed.
Yeah, I changed entirely.
But you know what was interesting? When we talked, you said what changed you? Because when you first got there, and you guys have to wear a suit every day, yes? Or a suit and tie? You have to wear a suit
every single day.
And so you said when you first got there, you were rebellious. You know what I mean? You still wanted your Tims, whatever you was wearing. What was you wearing?
Oh, no. I was, man.
You don't even know what you was wearing.
I was getting like detentions and everything.
So, but prior to that, what was interesting about our conversation, you said it was that really having to wear that shirt and tie every day that kind of really was the catalyst for your change. So tell our audience about what it was like, you know, rebelling against this suit and then actually having it become an inspiration for you to kind of fit the mold.
Yeah, I truly believe that I changed because of the shirt inside.
Why?
It was literally, like, I don't know, I just felt success wearing it. Because you physically feel the pressure on your neck and everything. So, you know, you can't have, like, the same movements you would. You can't act out. It kind of restrains you. Makes you walk a little bit more orderly. And I began to not only dress the part, but I started to walk the walk and talk the talk because of the shirt and the tie.
I love that, because part of wearing sagging is for comfort. You know, because what he's relating to is, like, you know, I felt constrained with the sagging. And do you see this, Alex? I mean, do you see it with young men, just the transformation that they experience when they do have to be forced to wear a shirt and tie?
I think it's empowering. Okay. I mean, I went to Morehouse College. And
shout out to Morehouse.
Shout out to Morehouse.
Morehouse.
I didn't hear them say that, but we hold that against them. And Morehouse, you know, that's it's the same culture.
Oh, yeah, I applied there too. I'm sorry.
Oh, good. It's, okay. It's the same culture at Morehouse. And I think it's something to be said when young men, when you see a group of young African-American and Latino men at Verbum Day lined up, it's a powerful symbol. And it changes the narratives of what we often see depicted in the media of young males of color. And it just, for a young man who has first put on a tie, I think it's a powerful moment in their lives.
Right.
I mean, to learn how to tie a tie. I mean, it's a symbol of manhood. And it's crossing, I think, into an area where young men can realize, hey, I can do it. I'm no different than anyone else. But I am always in awe when I see the Verbum Day students line up with their shirt and ties, because it's just a powerful symbol that we don't often see at all in our media culture.
I love it. You know, and I guess it's the same experience for little girls when we wear heels. Do you know what I mean? In purse, and we kind of feel girly. Do you know what I mean? Kind of
like
I'm gonna take your word for it.
I've never worn heels.
Michelle, right? Yeah, Michelle. No, okay. All right. Shout out to Michelle Jones in the house. Okay, so Zach, where were you before you went to Chase?
Honestly, I was down the street. I went to Simon Gompers Middle School on 112 in San Pedro.
Okay, so where is that for our audience?
It's located in Watts, not too far from Dickinson Garden Projects. So you know, like, life in Watts was just normal. That was routine for me. So I was, my home school was Locke High School, which is like historically known for like riots and, you know, gang wars and stuff like that, all involved in school. So that's what I was looking forward to. My older brother had went to the Verb, and I really didn't see myself going to the Verb because
you're also legacy.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I really didn't see myself going to the Verb because it was all boys school, and I wasn't really interested in boys.
Right.
Like, you know.
That's
so
good.
I didn't see myself going there, but I ended up getting into some trouble, and I got put on probation. So that was like one of the terms of my probation, is to go to Verb.
Okay.
So when I went, when I first arrived at Verb, I was expecting like super gang members, because it's like, like, they share a wall with the Dickinson Garden Project.
It's right next to the project.
But they literally share a back wall, like half the school. Like, this part of this, like the right side of the school shares a wall, like a brick wall that's like 12 feet tall with the projects.
Okay.
So I was expecting kids that from the projects to be just be going there in mass quantities. When I got there, it was completely different. It was like no racial tension whatsoever. Mm. And the previous school I went to was like, like the blacks stayed on this side and the brown people stayed on this side. And it was like, you couldn't cross that side, it's gonna be a riot.
Okay.
Like, so every Friday, that's what it was. People, like, they would set up time for riots to start. And then our school would be on lockdown for like 4 hours.
Wow.
So a lot of times we wouldn't leave
middle school.
Middle school.
Okay.
And then it would, like, somebody make a call and transfer over to Lock, and then it'd be a riot after school with high schoolers and everybody. So that's what I was used to. So
how did you feel having to wear that suit? How does it make you feel when you have to wear that shirt and tie every day?
For the first, I guess you could say, a couple of weeks, because our school started in July, because we had to get prep for SOAR and things like that, to learn how to work in corporate America. It was uncomfortable, and I felt like I had a magnifying glass on me. Because walking through, my mom didn't have a car or anything, so I was walking home from school, and everybody was just looking at me differently. I could feel people's eyes on me.
Okay.
They weren't looking at me differently in a negative light, but they were looking at me differently nonetheless.
Okay.
So I just felt different. But once I got to my job, Kirkland Ellis, downtown Los Angeles, on 3rd and Hope, I felt like it leveled the playing field. Because instead of people looking at me like I'm about to steal something out the store, like, people rushing to me to give me service because they think I'm an adult.
I love it. I love it. Thank you for sharing that. So I want to get a little bit more into your individual stories, because I was absolutely fascinated by these videos, Alex, that you showed at this dinner, because they're so engaging and emotional. And so we have a little bit of awe that we want to share from them. But first, before I do that, Chase, I want to start with you a little bit to share with us a little bit about your background and where you grew up.
All right, I was born in Fontana, 1997.
Okay.
You know, so I guess I was raised around, I'm not raised, but born in the Valley, because after
Fontana. You're a Valley boy?
For a couple years.
Till you came over to Verb Day.
Yeah. And after Fontana, we moved. Me and my family, dad and all, we moved to Moreno Valley.
Okay.
And then that's when my mom made a decision to flee, because my father was a very abusive man. So we went to live with my grandma in Carson.
Okay.
We've been living there for like about 14, 15 years or something like that. And I'll say I grew up there because I've done everything there. Mm-hmm. We weren't always like financially stable, you know, things weren't always there, obviously.
Right.
If you're raising multiple children, which is my mom, without an extra source of income.
Mm-hmm.
So she made the necessary sacrifices she had to and everything. And she underwent some pain within our life. She had a fibroid. She underwent a clinical depression because in the hospital she was raped.
What?
Yes.
But she was in the hospital getting,
like, recovered from her heart surgery.
Yeah.
Okay.
Like during the process.
Let me play a little bit of audio because I want you to talk a little bit more about your mom. Uh-huh. and some of her physical challenges and some of her health challenges that you have to kind of help support. So, Richard, I want to play the audio for Chase. So we're going to listen to a little bit from your video.
All right.
From the Beat the Odds. Where you talk a little about your relationship with your dad growing up and then and your mom and how you support your mom. So we're going to play this and check it out.
I just have also responsibility of making sure I'm going to become a better man. Because I don't have that father figure at home. In August of 2009, me and my mom, we were watching a movie, and then out of nowhere, all I hear is helicopters hovering over our house.
On a loudspeaker, they said, well, the residents of, and they said our address, and they asked us to come out of the house one at a time with our hands up.
And then I look out the window, all I hear is click, click, shotguns. I was scared.
They were searching for my ex-husband. Apparently, he was a suspect in a murder that occurred in Fontana at 1:48 in the morning.
Fontana police received several 911 calls reporting shots fired in this apartment complex on Barbie Street. 52-year-old Lewis J. Moore was arrested as he attempted to elude a police perimeter.
It was a very traumatic time for Chase. Every television station that we turned to, he saw them talking about his dad. I took them to court with me.
I saw a slender man in an orange jumpsuit that looked just like me. In those few moments, it further registered that was my father.
And that whole hour and a half ride back home, he cried. Chase has had to deal with me having diabetes, cardiomyopathy. I had a tumor removed from the chamber of my heart. I have sickle cell anemia. I have chronic obstructive pulmonary disease.
Every single day of my life, since I've understood that my mom was sick, I've made sure she's taking her medicine. Without her taking the multiple medications a day, she could die.
On top of that, I have 3 psychological side effects to deal with.
If I lose my mom, then I lose everything. She's done everything for me and everything for my brother, my sister, and my development to become a man.
He's been a caregiver, and that's a heavy burden to put on a young man.
You feel burden?
I feel pressure. Been the man of the house since the age of 14. Mm-hmm. Ever since my brother left out.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, at times I do feel pressure.
Your mama got more than fibroids. I mean, she listed numerous. Yeah.
She could die. She could die right now as we're speaking.
Numerous physical ailments, not to mention the psychological. And I'm sure she's having to care for 4 kids. Three kids. So I mean, what is that like? I would think that was a burden for me. Do you know what I mean? And you're only, how old are you?
I recently turned 18.
So you recently, when was your birthday?
A month ago, January 15th.
Capricorn. Oh, Lord. Anyway, so talk about that. So we started off because you talk a lot about your father not having a father, and mm-hmm. we showed a little bit about. So talk about what it was like for you growing up without a dad.
It was tough.
Mm-hmm.
It was hard. Like, you know, every Father's Day, you always see the commercials and everything. You can get your father this for Father's Day,
right,
or something.
Why, it's cool.
And, mm-hmm. and it hurt because I wasn't able to do that. So I just, I gave my mom a Father's Day present.
Okay.
And my brother, like, he's a couple years older than me. I'm 18. He's 20. But he's basically been like a father to me.
Mm-hmm.
He taught me how to ride a bike, tie my shoes, you know, everything. Taught me how to be a man.
Okay.
And it was kind of sucked for me a little bit.
All right.
That your brother has to be your dad. But, hey, it worked out. I'm standing here before you right now.
Absolutely. So what does it mean to you to be a father?
To take care of someone. And not walk out on someone. That's what it means to me to be a father.
Do you want
to
get married?
I do.
You do?
I have plans already.
Wait a second. You got plans?
No, I don't mean like.
Who is she?
No, I don't mean like that.
Well, you got plans for the wedding? What you got plans for?
Oh, like.
Well, let me know, bro.
Either name. Right. You know what I'm talking about?
I'm your best friend. You ain't telling me.
That's something we don't know.
No, it's not like that.
Okay.
I'm talking about I have like name plans. I have how many I want.
How many wives you want?
No, how many children I want?
I'm gonna say you need to move.
No,
you need to get out of this country. You want to have multiple wives?
I'm going to Utah.
Yeah, I have how many children I want?
How many kids you want?
I want 4 football players.
You want? What if they're girls?
Lingerie league.
Then it's a
boy. Uh-oh. Did you say lingerie league? Really, Richard? You gonna go to the lingerie league? Okay, so you want to be married. You want to have a wife.
Uh-huh.
What does it mean to be a husband?
To provide for my family, just like a dad.
Oh, can I step in on that one?
Yeah, what does it mean to be a husband?
To be a great father and a great provider.
What about for the wife? How do you support your wife? How do you support your partner?
By saying no when it's necessary.
By saying no, wait a second.
I'm serious, by like making sacrifices.
Okay. I thought you were telling her no.
No, just in general. Okay. If you have to like say no to something and, you know, aid towards your family or something, that's what it means to be a good husband.
So leadership.
Yeah. Before you have a wife, like, she's gonna go through a lot of like bad breakups and experiences her share of men, you know. So you wanna be that dude.
Yeah, you know.
I just know
experience.
That.
Experience.
Like, you've
seen some of these girls, like, you are going through it.
Not like that, but you know.
He just knows.
You're not gonna be with like your childhood sweetheart forever. So you know she's gonna have at least 4 or 5 boyfriends before she gets to you.
Wait.
Like, that's our generation.
What are you teaching you every day? How do you know?
That's our generation. Experience. Like, it's our generation.
So you know not to marry your high school. Can you marry your high school sweetheart?
You could. I'm just saying.
Is it realistic?
Not in this generation, no. It's not realistic, okay. Honestly. And I feel like you should be trying to be the man that the other men in her life weren't. Everything they didn't do, you should try to fulfill to the best of your ability and be the provider. And, like, you know, and, like, when she comes home, you should take care. Even if she's making more money than you. Like, take care of the bills. Like, make sure everything is paid for. Uh-oh. Make sure everything is good.
All right.
Be that person.
You already know that might be an issue, huh? She might make
more money than me, but I'm gonna pay all the bills and I'm gonna pay for the, you know, I'm gonna pay for the restaurant bills and everything like that.
I know that's right.
I'm gonna take care of the financial responsibilities, because it was times that, like, I was watching my mom like struggle. Like, I don't even know how she was getting up, walking to her car and driving away to work. And it was like, man, I wish my dad was here.
Right.
I wish somebody was here to take some weight off her shoulders.
Take some weight off.
I wish I could do something.
Right.
But I couldn't.
So you want to get married. And so who, your wife. So what does it mean? What is a wife? You know, what does it mean to have a partner? Who is the Bonnie to your Clyde? Who is your bae to your Jay-Z? Do you know what I'm saying? What is your wife, and how do you see her purpose in your life?
A wife is a Batman, and I'll be the Robin. Like, literally, they're the ones that, I mean, they give us life. Like, I wouldn't be talking before you without a woman.
Right.
Like,
but you know, the heart doesn't exist without the head. We need leadership.
Yes, I agree.
Okay.
But, like, the wife, they make so many sacrifices. Like, growing up, I seen my mom like skip meals just so that we could eat. So a wife is someone who also makes sacrifices.
Nice.
One who has unconditional love towards her children. And it's tough to see sometimes.
Okay.
Like, you don't always see that, but I guess with experience and just us being conscientious of everything, well, that's how we'll find one.
You love your mama.
Yes.
You love your mama. And you was crying on the video. You was crying at the award show. You love your mama.
I do.
Those are manly tears.
Those are manly tears. That's okay to cry. It's okay to cry.
I'm a man for crying.
I want you to cry. You absolutely. I love that you said that. You are a man for crying. Talk about your mama. Talk about the relationship with your mother. Richard, show her your picture. What's your mom's name?
Callion Moore.
Give her a shout out.
I'm going to give a shout out to Coach CJ at Verbum Day High School, one of the first female coaches at the high school level in California, or the United States for that matter. She's a superwoman.
All right. So talk about your mom. Why do you love your mother so much? Why is she so special to you?
I love my mom so much because she's also my dad.
Okay. Like,
she's my mom and my dad. She's made so many sacrifices for us, but she still smiles. I've never heard her complain. And shoot, the experiences we've underwent, they're reason for us to complain.
Right.
But she hasn't. She's, like I said, she skipped meals for us. She's always found a way. We might have a nickel, but she'll make a dollar out of it. She'll make it mean something.
Okay.
There will be weeks we're pushing on nothing, but she still finds a way to have gas money and get me where I need to go.
So what does she say about, you know, the things that you're doing and the growth that she's seen you do since, you know, your clown, your class clown days? She's seen this magnificent evolution of a man. Well, I know she's proud of you.
She is. She often says how phenomenal I am.
You are phenomenal.
And I try and play things humble and everything. Okay. And just say, thanks, Mom. I really appreciate it. But, like, it means a lot.
Okay.
She always gives me a hug, a wet kiss, unfortunately. But, like, she's just so proud of me.
Okay.
And I know that I'm doing the right thing so far. And I plan to provide for her one day, just as she did for me.
Nice. Now, before we go to commercial break, I want you to share with our audience, who are some of your role models? And who has taught you and been more impactful on your growth and development as a young man?
Okay. My mom, of course. As I stated just now, she's my role model. Mm-hmm. My brother, in addition, because he's played a father figure role for me. He's taught me nearly everything I know as a young man.
Right.
My best friend right here, Zachary Burge, aka Zeebo.
Mm-hmm.
He inspires me, man.
Okay.
Because he's honestly not supposed to be right here right now. He's either supposed to be in a casket, in jail, or just, I don't know, somewhere being a father.
Mm-hmm.
But he isn't. Ray Lewis.
Yeah, tell me about Ray Lewis.
Man,
because we know football is very important to you guys. We're going to talk about that. How was Ray Lewis? How was he a role model to you? And what do you get? What do you gain from modeling him?
The greatest thing I've gained from Ray Lewis is tenacity.
Okay.
And that is holding grip, not letting go of what you believe in. He has many inspirational videos, and he's also another father figure for me, because he's taught me to never give up, to just continue to reach for my dreams. So he's definitely a person that inspires me.
Nice. Well, you stay connected to the CDF, Children Defense Fund. You're going to meet him eventually.
Yeah,
because they got contacts.
Year.
You know what I'm saying?
Trying
they
to
got
have him next year.
Oh, fantastic. Thank you so much, sweetie,
for
sharing your story. We're going to come back. We're going to talk to Mr. Zach a little bit more.
Let's
into his story and share a little bit from his Beat the Odds video. We're talking to young men who have beat the odds. You just met Mr. Chase Moore, and we're going to introduce you to Mr. Zachary Burge Zeebo when we come back. So give us a call here, 323-473-3100.
3-2-3-4-7-3-3-100. In internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
Hi, this is Tika Lark Fleming inviting you to join me every Thursday at 7 p.m. Pacific Standard Time for MP Chronicle Presents The Black Girl Show. Join us as we discuss politics, pop culture, and the other side of Black LA. So don't forget to tune in to MP Chronicle Presents The Black Girl Show every Thursday at 7 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, exclusively on latalklive.com. You can also catch us on iTunes Radio R&B or watch us on ustream.tv. Reality radio handcrafted for your listening pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk.
Hubert's Lemonade, tasty, refreshing, sweet, and tart. Happiness in a bottle. Visit Hubert's Lemonade at hubertslemonade.com. Once again, that's hubertslemonade.com. Happiness in a bottle. Xavier Tees and Tots, groundbreaking fashion, forward street smart designs. Tees and Tots for men, women, and boys. Visit xavierusa.com. Once again, that's xavierusa.com.
You like that, Zay? I don't see you bobbing your head. What's up?
I was bobbing my head.
You got to bob harder than that.
You know what I'm talking about? Stevie.
Nah, Stevie, you got to just jiggle a little bit. You can't.
Welcome back. Welcome back to Keep the dialogue. Real talk, real people. Tonight we are having conversations with the next generation, and we are meeting some young black men who are beating the odds. And before commercial break, we met Mr. Chase Moore, and we're going to meet Mr. Zachary Berg now. But before I do, shout out to my sister and my daddy who are watching. Hi, daddy, who's in NYC with my sister Raquel, Dr. Raquel Quarles. So you guys give my sister my daddy shout out.
Hey. Thanks for watching.
And I want you to meet my dad because he is a real estate developer. And we talked about that. Yeah, do you know what I mean? And opportunities for you to expand your thoughts on how you can use your architectural engineering passion and maybe think about real estate development as a career opportunity. So we're going to talk about that. I want to introduce you to my dad, Mr. Zachary Bugzebo. How you doing, sir?
I'm doing good. I'm doing great, actually.
Glad to be here. Before we get into a little bit of audio from your video, share with our audience a little bit about your background and where you grew up. You did say you grew up in Watts, but you're a transplant from here. You're not from L.A.
Oh, no, I'm not from L.A. I was born in Tacoma, Washington.
Tacoma, Washington.
So, you know, like about 15 minutes outside of Seattle.
Okay.
So, yeah.
And how old were you when you came out here?
I was about 2 when we came out here. After my mother's grandparents died,
okay,
my father and my mother got a separation, so I don't actually have any memories of my dad growing up, honestly. I mean, I think I know how he looks, kind of, but not really, though.
Okay.
So I like thinking of myself as Watts' finest.
You like thinking of yourself as Watts' finest?
Yeah.
Nice. Okay.
So that's when I wake up with that ideology. So I'm Watts' finest. I'm the finest product my community can produce.
I love it. But so in your video, you did mention that it was a kind of a culture shock when you first got, you know, to Watts and kind of, you know, experiencing that environment as you grew up. So talk a little bit about, you know, just being, I mean, you said you were right down the street from gang members, you know, you was fighting up at Gompers. Talk about just what it's like to grow up in, you know, I mean, a disenfranchised community like Watts.
Growing up in Watts is just tough. It's a community that will make you or break you, literally. Mm-hmm. And you're tested every day. And, like, it's no room for kindness. Like, me and Chase often have this conflict. I don't really know how to express emotion in a loving way.
You want to give you a hug?
No, I don't want a hug.
I'm going to give you a hug anyway.
All right. But, like, I just don't really know how to express emotion in a loving way because, like, that was a sign of weakness growing up. And, like, it wasn't really like, okay, yeah, bro, you can be all, like, nice and you can hug people. It was like, all right, bro, you can't show any emotion. And
just heard your boy say real man cry.
Yeah, but...
real man show emotion.
Real man do, but that wasn't the community I grew up in.
I love it.
We grew up in two different worlds. So growing up in Watts, it was just, like, hectic, really. When I first arrived there, I wasn't the average kid. I spoke fluent English. Mm-hmm. So people kind of looking at me like, oh, you're talking white. Mm-hmm. Or... why are you talking like that?
Right.
So I was kind of the pun of people's jokes, and I was really chubby too, so I was picked on for that.
Okay.
So you kind of had to learn. You kind of had to grow up faster than what you normally would, and like you weren't allowed to mature at a slow rate. So at 7, you know, you were taking the train to come out. My mom didn't want me to go to school and watch, so I was taking the train to Carson to go to school at Town Avenue, and I was just getting bussed out, and then finally I was like, I'm not gonna take the train anymore, I'm gonna just go to Gompers. And I went to Gompers, and when I got there, it was like a whole other world. It was like a prison. It was a school, but it was like a prison. And it, like, people were ditching school, people were smoking weed, people were doing sherm, people were doing like meth at school, and it was like, you know, girls were selling their bodies at school. It was all kind of crazy.
Girls selling their bodies?
Yeah, it was just like, it was crazy. It was like a war zone there.
And this,
like,
is middle school?
This is middle school. People bringing guns to school, people bringing knives to school. We have random searches every day, like stuff like that. And like randomly classrooms would get searched, and if you got caught with a weapon, they take you right to LP and things like that. And it just kind of molded you, and there's rules. If someone said anything to you that you didn't like and you didn't protect yourself, you became the target for everybody.
Now one of the things that you experienced, which I don't know anybody else who's ever experienced death the way you did at a young age, but you saw your best friend get killed. At what age did this happen?
This happened when I was 13 years old.
Share this, what happened as you witnessed your friend get killed.
It was a normal day, honestly. I had gotten into a fight in the bathroom right before we left school. We had gotten into altercation with the other boys during class. We got to a fight, we squashed that. Walking home from school, we stopped at the ice cream shop to get a scoop of ice cream. Come outside, two Lock high schoolers were arguing with these grown men out of their car, and then they just start shooting. Like, one of the men hopped out of the car, another one just was shooting from inside. So it was 3 men in the car, and they were shooting. And then they just, I remember, like, I just hit the ground, and it's crazy because if you've never heard a gunshot up close, it's so loud, it makes your ears go out. Mm. And all you hear is the pop, 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 and you can't hear anything else. And after the shot ceases, you have this ringing in your ear, and everything's moving slow, and glass is hitting your face. And then, like, you look, and you feel, like, warm stuff on you, but it's not your blood. It's, like, Devin's blood. Aww. So you're, like, you look in, and it's, like, really your heart is beating fast because you can't believe it. He's just looking at you like, I'm shot. Mm-hmm. It's like a hole about the size of a 50-cent piece or like two quarters put together, and in his stomach, like a couple of those in his stomach, and like you don't even know what to say to somebody at that time, because at that time he just knew that he was going to die. So he just was like, "Tell my mom I love her. I love you, bro. Like, you can make it. You can do everything you want to do." And like, I didn't think I was going to die like this, and then he pretty much died. And like, when the paramedics come there, like, you can't really tell them what happened because you don't want to be labeled as a snitch or something like that. So you can't really tell them what happened to the people that did it, even though you see the people that did it.
You did see the people that did it?
You see the people's face. You saw the people in broad
daylight. So you never testified?
Never testified, okay. And I know who did it. But at the same time, it was like, if I do that, it's going to put my family in jeopardy. It's going to put his family in jeopardy. So really wasn't something you come speak out about. And they really don't investigate things like that because they just mark it down as gang violence. Mm.
Alex, I can't believe some of these exposures.
I mean, but
that some of these young black men in our communities are being exposed to in terms of the lifestyles. And I mean, how do you lose a friend at 13?
But these are the stories that we're hearing about each and every day.
Right.
And these are the stories that not just in Beat the Odds, but in the Freedom Schools program and the work we're doing with young people in juvenile justice camps. These are the stories that we're hearing. Mm-hmm. Young people who are going through significant trauma and going through these environments in which this is routine.
Right.
And this is why, as an organization that is focused on policy as well as programmatic work, we have to be mm-hmm. on the front lines.
Absolutely.
For folks and young people like Zachary and Chase.
Absolutely. We're going to play a little bit of your audio from your Beat the Odds video, and you talk a little bit, a lot, about your mom. You guys both talk about, you know, how impactful your mom is. So, Richard, we're going to play Zachary's audio from his Beat the Odds, and then we're going to talk to you about it afterwards.
Mm-hmm. We were homeless for about 3 months. We were living in my mom's 1975 Suzuki Jeep. In the morning, we would go to, like, the laundromat, and we would get dressed and, like, wash up there, and then she checked into my school.
And Zachary was real brave. He said, "Mama, just hold on, and it'll work out."
I really didn't grasp the concept that we're homeless. Like, in my eyes, as long as I was with my mom, I was good. My mom just always instilled, like, you have to be honest, you have to be trustworthy, you have to give 100% everything you do, you have to have integrity.
We know she can't give us a lot. She couldn't give us a lot growing up, but, you know, she did give us a lot of love.
No matter what, as long as we were a family, we could make it. So we always try to stay close, knit, and we always try to help each other.
My mom and my dad. So on Father's Day, I bring her the Father's Day card made at school. And on Mother's Day, I bring her the Mother's Day card.
My mom, when I found out she was sick, she was actually getting in the car with me. It was her birthday, and she's like, "I have a headache." And I asked her, "Well, how long have you had this headache?" And she said, 2 days.
They said that I had brain cancer, and they told me that I probably have 5 years to live.
I always tell her that if she just died today, she didn't wake up tomorrow. I just wanted to let her know that she did a good job with me. I'm gonna be all right.
It relieved me. It made me say, well, I can die, and I know that my child will make it. We had to go on welfare, and it wasn't paying enough. So we were living off of $331 every month.
Sometimes my mom's sick, I have to, like, write her checks out, take the check, and I take it to the Department of Water and Power. If I didn't do that, because wouldn't get paid, we'd lose the house.
How do I think Zachary was able to balance his life, his schoolwork, his job, his mom? I don't know. I look at him all the time, and I'm like, you're one of the strongest people I know at 17. He's amazing. I don't know. He never complains. Like, his mom is sick. He still has a 4.0. I don't know how he does it.
You get a 4.0?
4.2.
4.2. I stand corrected. Your sister love you.
Yeah, she does.
She was on there boohooing. And shout out to my soror. What's your sister's name?
Lanice Yarber, or Dr. Lanice Yarber, excuse me. Roper, wait, hold on. Dr. Lanice Yarber Roper, she was just married.
Oh, congratulations. Why were you smiling during the video? I saw you smiling.
Because they played a picture of her face, and she looked funny when she was crying.
You and your sister are close?
Yeah, my sister are close, even though, like, over the, like, past, I want to say 3 years, are we kind of growing apart? I feel like, because it's like she wants me to do so well, and she often expresses how much potential I have and how much greatness she sees for me, but like she doesn't want me to get comfortable or like settle into singing or anything like that. So she puts like a lot of pressure on me. Sometimes I feel like she puts a lot of pressure on me. She wants me to be so great.
It don't seem like neither of you guys have senioritis. You can't afford to have senioritis.
You can't afford to have senioritis.
You got senioritis a little bit?
No, I'm saying, what is that?
Oh, you know what's it? Don't even worry about it. You ain't got it. Don't even worry about it. Your mom, you talked about being homeless.
Oh, yeah. Like, we were homeless. It was crazy. Because, like, my older sister, she had, like, a one-bedroom apartment, so my other brother and sister went to go stay with her. And I didn't really have to stay with my mom or anything like that. My sister gave me the option to you know, to stay with her. But, like, we really didn't have room for my mom, too. My mom didn't really want to stay, be a burden to my sister, so she was going to just sleep in her car. And I wasn't going to let my mom sleep in her car by herself, so I just went and slept with her. Because that's my mom.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I know she'd do the same thing
for
me.
You love your mama, too.
Yeah.
Y'all love y'all mama. You know what I mean? And there is nothing wrong with that. Both of them. I mean, both your mothers are dealing with serious health concerns. Serious health. I mean, your mother was diagnosed with brain cancer.
Yeah.
How long has she been living with brain cancer?
The doctor said she'd been living with brain cancer for, I want to say, like 4 years. And she's been sick for a while, it seems like. Or, like, according to the doctor, she's been sick for a while, but you never notice it because she never complains about headaches or anything like that, or chronic migraines. Mm-hmm. Apparently, she's been having those. She never complains about anything. And, like, you think, like, wow. You kind of feel bad, like you kind of are angry at yourself for not noticing that she was sick and not making her go to the doctor when she should have been going to the doctor.
Mm.
So you kind of manage yourself a little bit, but then you kind of like, oh, well, like, what can I do to help? But you can't do anything to help because you, like, cancer is incurable.
Right.
Like, you can do radiation, stuff like that, but that's not like guaranteed remission. Mm-hmm. So you kind of just have to pray on the things you can't control and like hope for better days. And like, that's
so
kind
of. So you guys
are
both kind of dealing with just the uncertainty of your mother's health.
Mm-hmm.
which weighs a lot, and I'm sure that that's a lot of the experience of some of the guys in your program, that they have mothers, single moms that they're raising, that may be dealing with a multitude of issues that they have to still be responsible for in terms of being the father in the hospital, just also their own personal academics.
I mean, what you're seeing and what you hear oftentimes of the young people who are coming through the Beat the Odds program are really the impacts of poverty, which is a domino effect. No job. The primary caregiver has left or is not around, so the mother is working oftentimes jobs that do not provide a living wage. There's no access to health care.
Right.
And so when you have parents such as Zachary and Chase's moms who've gone through extreme health issues and no access to health care, that puts a strain on the family.
Right.
And it has significant consequences in terms of transportation to school, in terms of putting food on the table. I mean, so what you are hearing are really the root causes and some of the significant outcomes that come from children who are placed in extreme impoverished conditions.
Right, absolutely. And you already heard him say you have a 4.2 GPA. I don't even know what a 4.2 looks like. 4.2 on a report card. I don't even know if I got past 3.5, but a 4.2, what you got?
Same as you, 3.5 too.
It's okay. You can join the club.
Oh, no.
I'm going to
get
UCLA.
A 4.0
okay.
in college.
All right, you get a 4.0.
He's being modest. He got like a 3.8 right now.
Yeah, 3.8. You know what I mean? So, I mean, you got 4.2, 3.8. You know what I mean? You have, you know, mothers dealing with, you know, health concerns. I mean, you guys are absolutely amazing that you just kind of continue to keep this focus. I mean, what distracted you from the gangs and not being involved? What prevented you,
actually,
you know, from
going
down that route?
Nothing really distracted from me from the gangs. I have friends that are in the gangs, and like for it, like that was exciting to me, and I wanted to be a gang member for a long time. The only thing I aspired to be was Frank Lucas.
So what prevented you from doing that?
Like, I don't know. I didn't see any future in there for me. Like, Devin got shot, and like as I got older, more and more of my friends started to just drop like flies.
Mm.
And I was like, okay, so it's 3 paths for me right now. Okay.
Okay.
I can actually 2 paths. I can go to school, or I can die, or 3 paths. I was right. Or I can go to jail. And I was like, I'd rather just go to school and be a doctor.
Nice. So one of the things that in our pre-interview that stood out to me that was absolutely fantastic that you had talked about is just the strength of Black women.
Mm-hmm.
And how you appreciate the strength of Black women. And when you're growing up in a generation, you know, to be perfectly honest, you know, some Black men talk about the strength of Black women, you know, not understanding it, not embracing it, but you embrace Black women's strength. What do you love about Black women's strength?
I just love their ability to adapt, to survive. Like my mom, like Chase says, my mom and my dad. So like, you know, she had to teach a young black man how to be a man mm-hmm. in a society that fears you.
But what you did was you correlate this to slavery when
yeah,
we talked.
Yeah, correlate it to slavery. In slavery, like Willie Lynch area, when they remove the father from the household, so the mother takes on responsibility, the mother and the father, and has to raise the men, to like has to show them how to be men, even though her like she herself is not a man,
mm-hmm.
and like she has to show you how to provide for the family, and like she has to teach you all the things that a man is supposed to teach you, that a man should know, from her perspective, and like to me that was so amazing that my mom could tell me like what to do, when I was going through changes or like how to face. Like racial oppression and things like that, or racial discrimination, and like never complaining, never crying. Like my mom's, I believe, 56, and I've never seen her cry once.
Mm, okay.
And so like they're just being so strong, and a lot of people are scared of the black women connotation and them being loud and you know kind of mean. But I kind of embrace that because like you know most cultures women are very concealed and like don't talk and wear things over their heads to conceal it, and like are very just like covered up and like not asked to just be an individual. And like most black women that you see, like a lot of people say that black women are just video girls or hoes and things like that, and like they call them bitches and stuff all over Facebook and Instagram, mm-hmm. and like that's not really what I think of when I think of a black woman. When I think of a black woman, I think of you or the ladies at Delta or Michelle over there. I think of my mom, educated black women that are doing stuff for the community, like Miss Marion Wright Edelman, people like that.
Richard, can I get some claps on some black women shout outs? I love it. Thank you. So I want you guys both, so you guys do understand the importance of slavery and its impact on us generationally, yeah. right? You know what I mean? You mentioned Willie Lynch, and I went to UCLA, and I didn't find out about Willie Lynch until I got out of UCLA. So it's important, you know what I mean, that you guys have this knowledge at this age and you understand your history. So what do you understand about the impact of slavery and how it's, you know, passed down generationally on black people? The impact.
I know a nice amount about it. I take ethnic studies at Verb, mm-hmm. which is a class developed on...
Shout out to Jovell.
Yeah, Mr. Jovell. Yeah.
Are you getting an A in that class? Oh. Y'all better be getting an A-plus in ethnic studies. Okay.
We're trying. They trying to play us, though. We trying.
Yeah, but it's a class framed on, you know, race and everything, knowing who you are. So I took it upon myself and in the class to learn my identity. I understand that I am... my heritage lies in Africa,
mm-hmm.
but the problem with that is that's as far as we know, and it's like a generational epidemic right now because we act out like we don't know exactly what country we're from, from Africa, and some people tend to say, "Oh, I'm not African booty scratcher," or you know, they don't.
They still say African booty scratcher.
I mean, boys in the hood.
Chase is just corny.
Boys in the hood, they say it.
Yeah.
But yeah, moral of the story, we as a community, collectively, in our generation, we're not necessarily taking pride in being African, being African, like, and that's why it's very important to understand the heritage of slavery and everything, mm-hmm. know where you derive from.
So but even though you don't know where you came from, you know.
No, I actually do.
Oh, you did? You did the DNA?
Research and family.
But like, but my point is, even though you don't know maybe specifically, and maybe you do and you don't, but you do know that you're a king, yes?
Oh, yes.
You do know that you're a king, yes?
Well,
you
guys king are right now.
Huh?
You guys are queens.
I was about to say, you know you're supposed to marry some queen.
Yeah.
All right? You're marrying some queens, yes?
Yeah.
Okay, very good. Both of you guys play football.
Yes.
And you had mentioned that Ray Rice was your...
Ray Lewis.
Ray Lewis. I always do that. Sorry. Ray Rice. See, you see why Ray Rice is in my mind, right?
Yeah, we know.
So, okay. So, but what I want you guys to talk about and what you shared with me is how football really has impacted you and it helped you in terms of just all the benefits that you get as young black men playing football. So talk about the importance of football to your life and how it's helped made you the man that you are today.
Okay, football is in my outlet. Like, it's landscaped me into the individual I am today. I started off playing football. I was nine or 8 years old. I was playing with 10-year-olds.
Mm-hmm.
So it's obvious, or we can assume that I was smaller than everyone, which I was. But I developed a sense of aggression, but like controlled aggression. I understood I was small, but I was able to. It was kind of like David and Goliath story every single day for me, because I was small, but I learned that I could face any obstacle if I truly have faith and really believe in myself. I was getting blasted every single day,
right?
But the thing is, I was getting back up,
mm-hmm.
and now I turned into, and this translates to the world because the odds are obviously stacked against me, and they still are right now. But
balls in the air.
But I know that I can still fight. I can still go for it. And also, football has played a avid role in my life because don't have a father. Mm. So the coaches, the counselors, the Love teammates, it. The brotherhood, like all of that stuff.
And one thing you said that you got from your football mentor, Ray, is his heart.
Yes.
But you said you have heart. I love I that you said heart. That. You got heart. You got, heart.
I got heart.
You got heart.
I'm not scared. I fear no man who bleeds. And that's because of football and what everyone that's ever inspired me in football has taught me.
Love it. Zach, how has football impacted you?
Well, growing up, a lot of the stereotypes that I saw and found myself embracing was black men being seen as angry or uncontrollable or violent or menaces to society. Like, I just saw that growing up all around me, and I didn't really have an outlet for my anger. I couldn't afford karate or something like that or boxing classes, so football became my outlet as well. And during practice, I don't like ghost off of my teammates. Like,
he don't ghost off.
I don't ghost off with my teammates.
You hitting? You hitting?
I'm trying to get. I'm hitting you as hard as possible, so that way on Friday I can hit the next person that I don't know even harder.
Okay.
So like, I don't really know what not well take easing up on the gases or something like that is. I'm trying to like tie myself up. I'm trying to give you everything I got, and I really didn't gravitate more towards mentors because I feel like I really didn't need a mentor. Mm. I really didn't.
Why do you feel like you didn't need a mentor?
Because I always feel like I know what I'm doing. I know what I want to do.
When's your birthday?
November the 6th.
Okay. Go ahead.
So I really didn't feel like I needed a mentor, so I didn't really gravitate to one. But they gravitated to me, seeing that I needed guidance, of course, and I tried to push them away, but they just kept messing with me. So eventually they became my mentors.
Uh-huh.
And I felt like I found brothers. And I made friends in unexpected places.
Yeah, like George Jimenez, Nicholas Stinson, you know, Zeebo, of course.
Yeah.
I mean, you guys are like the best of friends. I mean, you guys are teammates. Yeah, you guys.
It wasn't always like that. I actually hated Chase the first time.
What?
The first day, the first couple of weeks I met Chase, I did not like him.
You know what? Some of my sorority sisters felt the same way about me, and they know who they are.
I had a certain hairstyle that he thought was unsatisfactory.
Oh, yeah. He had a perm.
You had a perm?
Yeah.
You had a perm?
He had a spiky perm.
Who were you trying to be? Al Sharpton?
Every black boy's had a one point in their life.
Never had one.
You definitely
had a Derrick curl. Yeah. A Derrick curl is a perm.
Nope, never had one.
Yes, you did.
No, I didn't. No, I didn't. I ain't lying. Look at my hair. I just wear it naturally.
You happy to be nappy?
I am happy to be nappy. Throw some conditioner and make it soft.
I told you that.
No, you didn't.
Okay, so I want to get to Alex because we're running out of time, but quickly. So, how did you guys? How did you find out about the Children's Defense Fund and applying for the scholarship? And how has that changed your life after being awarded this magnificent honor?
I found out about the Children's Defense Fund because of my brother, because he was also, I want to say, a 2010 recipient.
Okay.
So like seeing him be benefited with a laptop, $10,000 scholarship, a whole bunch of guidance, the CDF Freedom Schools and everything. Mm-hmm. I understood it was a program that I wanted to also participate in.
Yes, sir.
So, and I would like sit in on the meeting sometimes, like when he would go to it and stuff. So I felt it was only right.
So was it as rigorous as Alex said, the interview process?
Oh. Man, no. Honestly, I think it's even more rigorous.
What? You think it's even more?
No, what? Even more. I think he's kind of...
You prepared to pledge? You prepared to go to the Army? You prepared to do anything after going through the process with CDF?
It's hard.
The interview process has nothing.
They test your emotions.
They said the interview... Oh, really?
No,
I said... It's psychological warfare after the years? For 10 grand?
No, like that. I'm not saying it wasn't nothing, but I'm saying
possible.
Like...
It's possible.
Any other interview process will be nothing compared to their interview process.
Is that right?
What I'm trying to get to.
Yeah, they don't want like just like an Uncle Tom type of kid.
Uncle Tom, that is hilarious.
Oh, like it's for the younger generation.
Yeah, okay.
How'd you find out about it?
I saw Chase doing something like that for like weeks at a time, and then like, he didn't tell me. He wasn't going to tell me
you
about it.
You weren't going to tell him you got some money.
It's not like that. Like,
nah, you weren't going to share the wealth.
We weren't that tight.
All right.
Yeah, we sit next to each other in class, but it's cool though. So I saw them working on it. And then my principal walks into me like 3 days before it's due and drops it on my desk like, do this or you're going to get a detention. I was like, okay, I don't want
if
a detention.
If you didn't apply, you were going to get a detention.
Yeah, and I was like 3 minutes away from getting on probation. So I was like, nah. So I filled it out, and then I turned it in to my principal, and then like he looked over it, and then he gave me my I guess you could say nomination and submitted it. And then like I wasn't expecting a call at all, because I was like, there's no way they're going to pick me. And then I got called in for an interview, and then it's the like last and final interview when I was a semifinalist was like crazy, because I walked into a room full of adults, and I was like, bro, like
it's going down.
I was like, why is there so many adults here? And they like established, because they're like, you know, of course there's some Caucasian people there, and you know, whenever they're around, I kind of just get nervous a little bit. But I was like, if I saw people like Miss Little there, and then they were just asking you questions about your life. So it wasn't really like, it wasn't really tough questions to answer, but they were tough to answer because you wanted to answer them in a way that was like pleasing to the people that are the audience. And I found myself just being blatantly honest because I couldn't be any other way at that moment in time because I was so nervous. So I just tell them like the real, like what I wanted to do in my life, where I see myself going, where I could be, like who I am. I want to be who I was.
I love it. Give him a round of applause, Richard. Alex, we're running out of time, but I did want to ask you, you did an excellent job in choosing these two young men, but what has it been like for you personally continuing this magnificent legacy that Marion Wright Edelman has started and you know, investing in these guys? So what has it been like, heading up this organization here?
It's a wonderful experience. It's a natural extension of my commitment to improving the lives and outcomes for young people. Mm-hmm. Let me say this. The significance of the Beat the Odds program extends beyond Chase and Zachary. And they talked about the rigorous nature of the application process. It's rigorous because there are hundreds upon thousands of young people just like them.
Absolutely.
And we know that if we only give them a chance, an opportunity, they will succeed, they will thrive, and they will do things like Chase and Zachary and Sequoia and Elizabeth and Timothy, our finalists and our honorees from this year did.
How can people support them?
Let me encourage everyone to go on to www.cdfca.org. You can apply online for the 2015 Beat the Odds. Application is open, which will be for the 2016 class.
Okay.
At the same website. Call us at CDF. Shout out to Michelle Jones and Sada Soto. Who are former, Sada Soto is a former honoree who is the program director for CDF. Michelle is our youth programs coordinator, and it is them who are leading this effort in the office for CDF California, who make sure that these young people are supported each and every day. And I want to just give them some love. And thank you again, Starlett,
for
having all of us.
Will you bring
your
girls back?
We will bring them back.
I love the work that you're doing. I definitely want to get more involved in your work with the Freedom Schools and helping our incarcerated black men. Yeah, how can people find you, sweetie, if they want to support you? How can people find you if they want to follow you?
You can follow me on Instagram at swaggy.chasej.
J-A-Y. Swaggy.chase, really?
Yes.
That's it?
Oh, no, of course it's not it. Also, my email.
Okay. Wait, you want to give out your email? You can.
Yeah, chase.more with two O's at verbumdayhs.org. Please contact me.
Very nice. How can people find you, sweetie?
You can follow me on Instagram at young_king_zebo. So that's YUNG_KING_ZEEBO. You can add me on Facebook. My name is Zachary Burge. BYRGE is the last name. And also my email is zachary.burge@reverendayhs.org.
I've been pronouncing your last name wrong all the time. You didn't correct me. Why didn't you correct me?
I just, you know, you fam.
Oh, yeah. And my Facebook is also Chase, then J-A-Y. You could also do that on Facebook.
Fantastic. Thank you so much, you guys, for joining us here this week. And thank you for, I know we're a little bit behind time, but thank you so much for tuning in as we have conversations with the next generation. We're going to have some young females on, young ladies on next week. Thank you to my show engineer, Richard Carr, Michelle Jones.
Thank
you, Richard.
Thank you
for
helping coordinate this.
And so make sure you tune in next week to the Dialogue, Real Talk, Real People with me, Starlett Quarles, signing off as my mama's child and my daddy's baby girl. Until next week. God bless you.
We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.